Hello, and welcome to Have Your Say. I'm Ann Minicozzi, president of the Community Breakfast Collaborative on Doing Racism Day, and welcome to Radnor Studio 21. And today our guest for Have Your Say is Sarah Wallace, and she is the, and you'll have to help me with the title because
sure.
We were just talking about it, the volunteer lead.
I'm the volunteer legislative lead for the Philadelphia chapter of Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America.
Good. Thank you. Yeah, it's long, but it's
yes.
It's well worth saying.
Right.
And we'll have that on the screen so people know. Well, welcome to the show. I'm glad we're able to record this. And I guess, first of all, we should talk about the Community Breakfast Undoing Racism Day event that we're working on, which will be September 18th from 7:30 to 9:30 in the morning at Villanova University, and everyone is invited to attend. For information, you can contact the Community Breakfast at comcast.net or ann.minicozzi@villanova.edu for information. We'll be publicizing that, and registration will be starting in about a month or so. But in terms of our breakfast this year, our theme is, we're co-presenting with Heeding God's Call to End Gun Violence, which is Brian Miller, who's the executive director of that organization. And we actually had him on a program a few months ago, also with the pastor of my church, Father Joe Genito,
yes.
To get the background on Heeding God's Call. But you're going to be the moderator of the panel, and the panel will, in addition to Brian Miller, will include Chief Mark Talbot from the Norristown mm-hmm. Police. He's the chief of police in Norristown, and then two Radnor High School students. But you have the role as the moderator for that event, September 18th. So what I want to cover today is really background about you and your involvement in Moms Demand Action, and how you became involved in that, and then we'll talk also about the community breakfast and what your hopes, goals for the conversation when you're facilitating that, moderating that, what you want to hopefully have happen.
Sure.
And there have been a lot of conversations about gun violence and gun safety, even more now than there were in the past. So this conversation that we have today, we know we're only going to have a certain amount of time to cover it. It's just a broad conversation. We'll have our panel on September 18th, and we'll dig in a little bit
yes.
more, but it's definitely an ongoing conversation that we're having and that other organizations are having as well. So hopefully this will be useful for people to understand at least part of the conversation and be encouraged to get into it more.
Sure.
So about you first. Can you give us some background about yourself and then how you became involved as the volunteer lead person for Moms Demand Action?
Sure. Well, I have lived here in Delaware County for about 15 years, but I grew up in a really small coal mining town in northeastern Pennsylvania, and my experience is sort of a microcosm of our state and the conversation around guns in our state. So there are very different cultural attitudes toward guns and gun safety and the laws involving guns in our state, which sometimes makes it difficult to have a substantive conversation about guns. So first of all, I'm very grateful that you and the Community Breakfast are encouraging us to come together, different members of the community with different perspectives and different
yeah.
approaches, to have a conversation via the Community Breakfast Collaborative on this topic. Some people would like you to think that it's an exceptional political issue, that we can't talk about it, that it's either all or nothing,
yeah.
us versus them, and the reality is that's not the case at all. There are a lot of, through moms, there are a lot of common sense gun safety policies and laws that we could advocate for that both improve public safety while also respecting the rights of responsible gun owners. And until we're able to have forums like this where we can actually come together and have a conversation about this issue, things won't change. But for me, I was sort of moved to action after the shooting at Parkland at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School.
Yeah.
And I was so overcome by the survivors, the students, who within days, hours of that horrific, traumatic experience had the fortitude and the courage to get out in front of this issue and advocate for change and lead the charge.
Yeah.
And I thought, if they can do it, how can I not? How can I continue to sit on the sidelines and not speak up on this issue? So I had been watching a friend of mine in Maryland who I really respect and hold in high regard. She had been active with Moms for a long time. Moms was founded in 2012 after the shooting at Sandy Hook Elementary.
Okay.
By Shannon Watts, by one woman.
Mm-hmm.
And we are now a 6 million member organization nationwide with chapters in all 50 states.
Wow.
Over 530,000 donors under the Every Town for Gun Safety umbrella. She started that with the hope of and the approach of treating it like cultural change. So thinking about like the MAD, the Mothers Against Drunk Driving movement,
right,
where when you think about where we were in the conversation around drunk driving not that long ago, with the involvement of sort of a mass movement like that led by Moms to encourage conversation and change, our cultural attitudes and thusly our laws changed along with that movement. So that was really her approach. But I had been watching the success that my friend was having in Maryland on some of these issues via her involvement with Moms Demand Action. So I had been sort of studying them for and watching for a while, but just never got off the sidelines until I saw the courage of those kids and thought, it's time. It's
yeah.
time to get off the sidelines. I went, Moms Demand has monthly meetings right here in the Philadelphia area. We move around from the suburbs to Center City.
Oh, that's good.
Mount Airy, Plymouth Meeting. There's also a chapter in Chester County, farther west here on the main line. I was able to plug right in there. They're highly organized, very professional. There are women who show up and get the job done, and I should say we're mothers and others. There are dads and men who are involved as well, deeply involved. But I went to the next meeting following the Parkland shooting, and I never looked back.
Yeah.
I have been to Harrisburg on numerous occasions. I've had in-district meetings with my own legislators advocating for gun violence prevention measures. And it's been an incredibly rewarding experience. Sometimes it can be frustrating watching the news and seeing, feeling like this is an uphill battle, that you're pushing a boulder uphill when you're trying to take on this kind of an issue. But there really are groups like Moms who every day there's something, whether it's fighting back a bad bill, fighting on behalf of a good bill, fighting for resources, for research and funding. Just yesterday, we saw a bad bill pop up on the state Senate's agenda and activated moms all across the state to make phone calls, get on Twitter. So there really is something, there's a place to put your frustration, to put that desire to change, to work in a very real and substantive way through this organization.
That's really good, because what you're saying about Moms Against Drunk Driving, how that was started by one woman, and then you're one person. We're all kind of separate in front of our televisions or newspapers or in our communities experiencing these tragedies or being outside of them and witnessing them but wanting to know what to do. So it's so important what you're saying, is that one person can make a difference and join in. And I think it's tremendous that Moms Demand Action is in every state.
Mm-hmm.
And also the network.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's the social media and everything, using email and other forms. You can be in touch with each other very quickly.
Instantly.
And also in terms of legislation that's coming up, mm-hmm. I know you can get on an email list to get alerts about bills in your state in a particular subject area, particular issue, so that everybody has such limited time that you can connect in these couple of ways and then immediately be connected to the whole thing where you can really participate and make a difference.
Yes.
So it's that's really good.
Yes.
That's really good to,
so a lot of our organization on this grassroots outreach happens via social media.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are watching and you are interested in getting involved, you can find us on Facebook. You can also go to the Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America website, type in your zip code, and it will direct you to your local chapter. But it's really important to get on the social media aspect of it. A lot of our organization does happen around social media. But being tied to a national organization, there is a wealth of research, actual data on what's working nationally. And some of the states are the chapters in other states, like New Jersey, where there are what we would consider better, more comprehensive approaches to gun violence prevention, better mm-hmm. laws on the books. Those tend to be federally focused chapters, so those volunteers are focused on what's happening at the national level, at the federal level. Pennsylvania is not where we should be in terms of our approach to comprehensive gun violence prevention measures. And so our chapter, our Pennsylvania chapter, is really state focused.
Okay.
So we do a lot of legislative work at the state level around gun violence prevention measures. And our number one legislative priority this session is something called an extreme risk protection order.
Okay, good.
Which is commonly referred to as ERPO for short, or red flag laws. And so that is our, we are not sort of attacking every angle. We are focused on one priority that we think has a really good chance in our legislature in the current time to get through.
And can you say specifically, do you know what bill number that is for Pennsylvania?
Yes. So there are two bills that are active right now. There's one in the House and there's one in the Senate. So it's HB 1750.
And HB is for House Bill.
That's right.
Because it's like another language
it
when
is.
You get into this. So
it is.
HB 1750.
Yes. Okay. And that was sponsored, prime sponsor is Representative Todd Stevens out of Bucks County.
Okay.
On the Senate side, it's SB, Senate Bill 90. And the prime sponsor there is Senator Tom Killian, who is I think he covers Delaware and parts of Delaware and Montgomery counties,
okay.
but they're both local to the, sort of the Philadelphia inner ring suburbs. And they're running on parallel tracks right now. They were introduced, one was introduced in February, one was introduced shortly thereafter. They're both in committee right now, so neither one of them has advanced yet. But earlier this year, Governor Wolf joined about 200 moms, members of Moms Demand Action, for our lobby day at the Capitol in Harrisburg, and spoke in support of ERPO, along with members of both the House and Senate. So we feel very encouraged about this bill's chances. It's one of those common sense measures that respects the rights of gun owners, but also has been proven. ERPOs are in effect already in 17 other states.
Okay.
So there's already really good data about their potential to reduce both suicide, firearm suicide, and mass shootings.
And let's stop and just say particularly what the ERPO bill is.
Sure. So an ERPO, an extreme risk protection order, is you petition a judge to get an extreme risk protection order to remove temporarily someone's firearms who is in a period of crisis.
Okay.
So this is it fills an important gap in our laws. The only, if a family member or a loved one is concerned about the well-being of a member of their family, a loved one, who may be going through a period of emotional crisis, there really is not, they don't have an option to have law enforcement temporarily remove the firearms from that very sensitive situation. The only approach right now is the 302 process, where it's means involuntary committal. So that's a very serious
of the individual. That's very extreme.
It's very, very serious, and it also comes with a lifetime ban on firearms.
Oh wow!
So
this is more on the order of a restraining order of an individual's guns.
Yes, it's temporary.
Yeah,
and there are really strong due process measures built into this legislation to make sure that there is a trial, that you can afford an attorney, that you can appeal during the period, the temporary period. So we feel, again, that this is sort of a balanced approach that addresses a real public health crisis in this country. Two-thirds of gun deaths are suicides. Two-thirds. Thousands of people in our country every year. So
it kind of puts a dialogue in place where there isn't one, which is useful, because it enables connecting the family in a legal way to the local police department, so that they can help this person, you know, not have their guns around if they are in a state of crisis where they might be suicidal.
Right, and when it comes to suicide, the means matters. Firearm suicide is the most lethal form of suicide. It's lethal in 85% of attempts. However, 90% of those who survive firearm suicide do not reattempt and do not go on to die by suicide. So it's really important. This is an impulsive thing.
Yep.
Suicide is an impulsive thing. And to be able to turn, to give families somewhere to turn in that moment of crisis, to temporarily restrict their loved one's access to the most lethal means, can really save lives.
Yeah. And what I really like about it also is just think about the family members and feeling so helpless and unable to help that person who they know is in a state of crisis. And if they can just take those weapons away, that's out of the equation now, and then it gives that person a chance, the person in crisis, a chance to hopefully move on from that impulsive feeling and not, move out of that suicidal ideation stage, hopefully, and then you could start to help in other ways once that's out of the equation.
Right.
Now, I know you've worked with the police,
mm-hmm.
and so what do the police think, and I'm thinking of the Radnor police and our police chief, Chris Flanagan, mm-hmm. What do the police think about ERPO? Do they find that helpful? Because I think what happens is, and then correct me, that the weapons would be taken from the home and held at the local police department, so they're right in town.
That's correct.
But how do the police feel about that? Do they feel that this is a useful bill that should be passed that would help them?
Well, I will say, the police really try to remain apolitical about this type of legislation. Their job is to enforce the laws for everyone, and they really try to avoid taking a particular side. However, I can say that, you know, some of these calls, whether it's domestic violence or someone who is in a moment of crisis, can be the most dangerous for law enforcement.
Yeah.
So one of the earliest states with an ERPO law, it was actually named in honor of a law enforcement, a police officer, who was unfortunately the victim of one of these volatile situations. So broadly speaking, it does have the support of law enforcement. But again, at a local level, the police do remain apolitical.
Yeah, that makes mm-hmm. sense. In terms of that, in a sense, wouldn't you think that anybody who wanted people to be safer and alive and able to deal with their problems if they are in a suicidal crisis, that mostly anyone should be in support of that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I just keep going back to the pain of the family members and friends who know that their friend or their brother or sister or whoever it would be is in this crisis and you just can't do anything.
Yeah.
So this would help them to be able to help
the
person.
The effects of this on families, suicides, but also gun violence broadly speaking, the effects of gun violence on the survivors is lifelong. Lives are never the same. And one of the things that we do within Moms Demand Action is try to provide support and voice to mm-hmm. survivors. So they are a very important part of our community. On Saturday, I'll be tabling at an event in Philadelphia called the Angels Picnic. It's the fourth annual picnic where mm-hmm. survivors come together in community to support one another, and moms will have a table there to help support them. We stand with victims at trials and at hearings just to show support for them in trying to move on from these life-changing incidents of violence.
We're talking about suicide a lot, but the other thing that I think we should take some time to talk about is the domestic violence mm-hmm. issue, especially in Wayne. We just had that tragedy very recently in the Wawa mm-hmm. where an ex-husband murdered his ex-wife in the Wawa, and she did not renew a restraining order that she had in place. And again, like we were saying, everybody's so busy, maybe she just wasn't able to get to renewing it. I don't know exactly the
people
details.
People can face all kinds
right
of challenges
Wayne,
to renew those types of things, protection from abuse orders. To your point, no community is immune from this.
Yeah.
You know, people would like to think that it's limited to certain neighborhoods or certain areas of our state. It's not. It can happen to anyone, anywhere. No one is immune from this, and that's why it's important for all of us to be engaged in conversation around these issues. I mean, it can happen anytime right here in Wayne on the main line.
Yeah.
Last year, we did actually have some success in Pennsylvania in passing the first measure of gun reform in the state probably in about a decade, and it was a domestic violence bill, which it was HB 2060, SB 501, which became Act 79 later in 2018, and that law helps quickly disarm convicted domestic abusers.
Okay.
So individuals who have been convicted of misdemeanor domestic violence or subject to a final protection from abuse order, they have 24 hours at a judge's discretion to turn in their weapons. Prior to that, and again, only in a judge's discretion, you could have 60 days to turn in your weapons if at all, you know, the judge ordered it at all. So we can't say that this would have been effective. We can't say for sure that this would have helped
yeah.
in every case or in this specific case, but certainly the victim, if she had been, you know, had secured another protection from abuse order and the judge agreed, the weapons would have been taken away.
Right, right. So I think our job here, having this conversation on Have Your Say, and then our conversation at the community breakfast on September 18th, is just to keep the dialogue going and the conversation going. Because now, if I talk to someone who wants to own their gun and go hunting and things like that, which is fine, but if we start to get emotional about the discussion, whatever piece of the discussion it is, because it's such a broad discussion to have, then we're not going to be able to talk and move further in the conversation. But I think talking about what's happening in families and with our friends and mm-hmm. what kind of a community do we want to have, how are we going to engage with each other, and then we just have to keep pushing and having these dialogues, and then also passing reasonable legislation that people can get on board with, you know, then we can start to get somewhere. Going back to Moms Against Drunk Driving, it wasn't a common phrase to have someone say, I'll be the designated driver tonight.
Right.
And
right.
now
right.
that is
very
pretty
common.
Routine.
Yeah.
People wearing their seat belts, people not drinking when they're driving is very common now. And hopefully our conversations and then the work of your organization that you're helping with and the other organizations too will help to move this issue along to where we can have that almost be ordinary, that, you know, we can take the weapons out of the household of someone who is suicidal so they have a chance to live. Mm-hmm. And just keep pushing and having those conversations and listening to each other. Mm-hmm. I think that's mm-hmm. what we, you know, we really need to do. So I'm so excited about your work and how you've become involved that way. And I hope that our viewers get inspired, and if there's something that they feel they need to respond to, that they're encouraged by your example and all the other moms and the dads and everyone else in Moms Demand Action.
Yes.
We should say the website. Isn't the website momsdemandaction.org?
I believe
so. It's
that's
the short,
correct, yes.
The short version, but people can Google and look at other aspects of things. And then you said that overarching organization as well.
Every Town for Gun Safety, yes.
Every
There's
town
a lot
for gun
of,
safety.
If you want a deeper dive on some of the data that supports some of these measures, you can find that on everytown.org. But if you want to get involved in the grassroots movement, seek out Moms Demand Action and plug in your zip code and you can find your local chapter. And there's plenty that you can do. Like, I love your approach, thinking about the beloved community.
That's what we want to be, the beloved community.
And thinking about what that means for families, for faith communities, for citizens. Mm-hmm. And there's really something, there will be something for everyone along those lines at the breakfast. So I'm excited to have that conversation. And I did want to plug one other thing, speaking about families. Through Moms Demand Action, we offer the Be Smart program.
Mm-hmm.
It's an acronym that stands for Secure Guns in Your Homes and Vehicles, Model Responsible Behavior, Ask About Unsecured Guns in Other Homes, Recognize the Role of Guns in Suicide, and Tell Your Peers to Be Smart. And what this does, we're always present here with the Radnor Police Department at community events. We've got Smarties to go with the Be Smart.
Which I love.
It's a very family-friendly approach. What this does is encourage families to think about gun ownership in their homes and also in family members and friends' homes.
Yeah.
So because you are a responsible gun owner, which means you keep your guns locked and unloaded and separate from the ammunition,
mm-hmm.
does not necessarily mean when you send your child to a friend's home to play or when you visit family over the holidays that those guns are also secure. And you can't make assumptions, and no one wants to be the parent in the home where something tragic happens because the guns weren't stored properly. And the onus can't be on children to avoid guns. The onus is really on parents to properly secure guns.
Right.
So the Be Smart program sort of coaches people on how to have these kinds of conversations, which
just asking the question.
And even, you know, moms today, you know, in my cohort, everything is done by text, so we're setting up play dates via text. And I know my kids have a bunch of allergies, so I'm always very sensitive when someone's coming to my home. You know, does your kid have any allergies, any aversions?
Do you have a gun in the home?
We're a pet-free, smoke-free, peanut-free, gun-free home. All of those sort of frees.
So you can just add it in.
It becomes part of a normal exchange between moms. So that's the kind of things, you know, those are some of the kind of things, in addition to legislative work, some of these more community-based things that you can find as part of Moms Demand Action.
Good. Well, our time is ending here, but we'll continue on September 18th.
Yes.
So thank you so much, Sarah, for being with us on Have Your Say today.
Thank you for having me.
I appreciate it. And if anyone has any comments or questions, you can email haveysay@gmail.com. Thank you so much for tuning in to Have Your Say.